This episode of Fireside Chat is brought to you by TickTix. Buying tickets shouldn't be anonymous. We are built for fans, by fans. Available on Android and iOS. Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another Fireside Chat, the official podcast of Flames fans. It's go time.
The Flames are back from their California road trip, and Matt and I are back, as always, to talk about the road trip and look at how the Flames are doing. And Matt, I don't know about you, but I'm not in the best mood tonight. This was not the result we wanted after our trip to California.
Well, I was figuring that 4 points on the road trip would be the ideal based on who we were playing, and anything more than that would have been a bonus. So the fact that the Flames walked away with two, it's a disappointment. But if you would have said to me, looking at those four teams, that we'd get 2 points, I'd be like, yeah, that makes sense.
But I mean, the score is one thing, and the score is ultimately what matters. But if we look at the play from those games, this was not the result we wanted in any way.
Well, it depends on which game. The LA game, that was the only legitimately terrible effort that the Flames had. And despite the score in both Anaheim and Chicago, the team played a lot better than what it ended up being.
Why don't we break those games down? Weird road trip. You and I were talking about this before we started recording tonight. The Flames played their last game in Calgary on the 30th. Then they flew to Chicago on the 1st. And then from Chicago, they flew all the way to California. So I don't know whose idea of a joke this is, but that's a really weird road trip. You think they could just bypass the Chicago game in there?
Yeah, or have a team closer to California, Dallas, like Colorado. Yeah, something that makes a little more sense than, oh, you're on the Eastern Seaboard. Now you're on the West Coast. Have fun with that.
And you know, the thing I think a lot of fans don't realize about these trips, too, is the time differences. You know, we just had our daylight savings time here and people are already feeling it. But when you go from, say, Calgary, Chicago to, you know, California, it's the time differences that get to these guys, too.
Oh, for sure. And you look at the Anaheim game, that was the first day after the daylight savings time. And even though the game started at 7:30, it's really an 8:30 start. And that just screws up your clock entirely.
So, yeah, I just look at this and I'm glad I wasn't on that road trip. Let's put it that way. I think even the media guys that were there are probably worse for wear right now. But starting at the beginning of the road trip, Calgary Flames went to Chicago to take on the Blackhawks. And we knew the Blackhawks would be looking for revenge in this one, and they got it. They got a 5-1 win over the Flames. Flames outshot the Hawks 34-22. And overall, I think this was a fantastic Flames game all the way around. I think the Flames were the better team all night, but the Flames, in my opinion, gave the Hawks too many power plays, and they let the Hawks do what the Hawks do. And I mean, the Hawks have a good team. That's why they've been so successful. And they let those power players, the Canes, the, you know, Taves, the Panarins, get too much time in front of our net.
Precisely. And for the first 47 minutes, the Flames looked like they were on their way to win the game. And then that one penalty resulting in a power play goal, and then the wheels fell off entirely. And realistically, it was a 3-1 game, not a 5-1 game. But it is what it is. And you're going to have games like that where you outplay your opponent significantly, but the other team gets a great goaltending performance, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Both times we've played Chicago, I think that Chicago's really been held in by the goalie. You know,
yeah, I can agree
the
with
first
that.
Time we played them, it was Crawford who looked really good. The second time we played them, it was Crawford that looked really good. Like, I think Crawford might just have our number this year.
I wouldn't be shocked when the Flames play them next week that Crawford will get the start once again.
I think that looking back at the first period of the Chicago game, I think this might have been the best forecheck that we've seen from the Flames even after this week. The Flames came out, they were forechecking hard. they were not just forechecking hard, but they were well positioned on that forecheck. I was really happy to see that. And I think that's a large reason why they were playing the better game, is for the most part, they were able to, you know, make Chicago make moves they didn't want to when they were coming into our zone.
And that's how the Flames need to play. And if they were playing an inferior opponent, they probably would have skated away with the 2 points based on how they were playing with their forecheck. They were controlling the play for the majority of the game. It's just that they weren't getting the bounces and the other team was.
A couple questions I had for you here. Looking back at this game, do you think that so far, up until this game, this was Tkachuk's best game of the season?
Probably.
And do you think that, and I mean, we saw this from him last year as well, Sam Bennett sometimes takes the worst penalties at the worst time. And I felt like it was Bennett, he played a good game, but I thought his bad penalty was really what led to giving up the game winner.
Well, Sam Bennett actually leads the entire NHL in most minor penalties taken, and he needs to get a lot more disciplined because he's really hurting the team in term, especially with the Flames having such a terrible penalty kill. It seems like every penalty is a terrible penalty to take.
Yeah, and I mean, we saw that from him last year too. I don't know if he's just not disciplined or he needs to work on his hockey sense. I mean, he's making too much now, but that's almost when you say to yourself, maybe this guy, we took him right from junior to the NHL. And that's where you think maybe this guy would have been well served by a year in the AHL.
Possibly. I have a question for you.
Sure.
Do you think that Matthew Tkachuk was the player that was actually making Sam Bennett look good in the first handful of games? Because since he's been put on the Michael Backlund line, all three of those players have really taken fire, taken off and are performing even better than they were.
I don't think it's just Tkachuk. I think that Frolik is having the best season so far that he's had of his career. I think that whole line is clicking there. I don't know if it's one guy. I think Frolik, like Brouwer, was kind of looked at to be the veteran guy with two younger players. I think that Bennett, if we look at that as, let's say, the second, maybe third line, depending on the night, I think that Bennett not having as big a role as he has in the past has helped him develop a little bit. And I think Tkachuk has definitely been a useful part of that line, but even when Tkachuk hasn't been on that line, I think that they've still looked good.
Oh, I'm just curious because it seems that as soon as Tkachuk got moved to the Frolik and Backlund line, the production from the Brouwer line fell off the face of the earth.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I think that just might be a sign of the times, too. I mean, you know, we're just not getting production from the top lines. But yeah, we'll see what happens going forward and where they keep Tkachuk going forward. To me, I have no other comments about this game. I think it was a good Flames game. We just got out-muscled, and I expected us to, you know, have to play hard. But I was expecting it to be a hard game, and it turned out to be a hard game. And I think that there's no shame in losing this game with the way the Flames played.
No, and you're going to have games like that, and you're going to have games later on in the season where you get massively outplayed and still walk away with the 2 points. It happens. Every season you have X number of games like that on either side of the coin. This one they deserve better. They didn't get it because Chicago capitalized on their small handful of chances, and that's the ballgame.
And I always say in a game like this, it's not about necessarily this game. It's about how you bounce back from this game and what you do the next game. And we saw the Flames when they made it to California take on the Sharks in their first game, and they did bounce back. They got the 3-2 win in that game. A game that I wasn't too sure how they were going to do. I thought they'd probably win. You thought the Flames were going to lose this one when we predicted last week. What were your thoughts on this game?
Matthew Tkachuk. They made the right decision in keeping him in the NHL.
I think that was really the game that showed that with his 2 goals.
Yeah, I think he was a little enthusiastic after being heckled by the coaching staff in the morning.
Yeah, and not only him, but England got 2 points in the night as well.
Yeah, it's interesting to see how he's changed his game, and he's becoming more comfortable jumping up into the play, where in years gone by, he'd be the guy back just letting his partner go and do that kind of stuff. So that has been one of the interesting developments. It's not often you see a 33-year-old defenseman radically change his game.
Well, he just seems more comfortable this year. And I mean, if I didn't know any better, I would almost think that England was the best defenseman the Flames have on the roster right now.
And I'd have to actually agree with you. That's a shock considering who's on the defense corps.
You and I talked about in the past how the best forward is Stajan. I mean, what does it say about our team if our best forward is Matt Stajan and our best defenseman is Derek England?
There's a reason why we're 5-8-1.
Even Vegas is going to have better stars than that, Matt.
Yeah. Well, hopefully this team turns it around soon.
Again, as we saw in the San Jose game, as we've seen so many other games, the Flames need to play better disciplined hockey. We had 14 penalty minutes to the Sharks, 8. And even though we won, I feel like if we could have stayed even strength for more of that game, we would have done even better.
Yeah, well, the penalty to start the third period, that allowed the Sharks to get back into the game with the Brent Burns goal. And
exactly.
If the Flames were a little more disciplined, then perhaps that they don't even get to tie the game and the Flames just walk away with a 2-3 win.
Well, and that's the thing. Like, we talk about how bad our power play and our penalty kill are, but we're setting ourselves up for that. Like, we're setting ourselves up to have to go on the penalty kill because we're taking some really silly penalties.
Lack of discipline from everyone, it seems. Not much you can say about that. You know, a lot of the penalties are blatantly obvious, like in the LA game, Nick Grossman just kicks his leg out and trips a guy. Well, yeah, that's 2 minutes. So.
But that's also why Grossman's been riding the pine for most of the season.
Oh, I know. That was the one that was on the top of my head that I could think of right away. Completely lack of discipline penalties.
We've talked about Brett Kulak so far. We've mentioned how he's going to need to get some play time, and he did on this road trip. What did you think of his performance in San Jose?
Kulak's been an interesting player. When he's good, he looks like TJ Brody did at his age. When he's bad, it's like, how is this player playing in the NHL? Like, I remember the Carolina game in Calgary. He made, 7 or 8 big mistakes in that game to the point where if I was coaching, I would have actually just sat him and just ran with 5 defensemen because he was that bad. But on this road trip, he came in and he's pretty much was the Flames' best defenseman in those 3 games. And what he needs to do to progress is to get some consistency in terms of playing good and not knowing what you're going to get on any given night.
Yeah, and I think just giving him the playtime he's had, like he's been in the lineup, like you said, for 3 games in a row, I think that's even going to help him just getting out there and, you know, playing his game.
For sure.
Especially for a young player, it's hard to do that when you're jumping in and out of the lineup.
Yeah, and it's one of those things where you can kind of look at who's struggling and who's performing well when you have 8 defensemen, and like Jyrki Jokipaka has looked terrible in the last handful of games, so perhaps he sits for a while and you bring Dennis Weidman back in, see how he does, and just keep rolling it until somebody struggles, then you pull them out of the lineup and run with one of the other guys.
And it's nice to have that ability to do that. I think it means we're not going to see a call-up defenseman anytime soon, which is fine. I think that all the guys in Stockton are fine in Stockton. But yeah, I think it's nice that we have that ability to rotate these guys in and out.
Yeah, Shillington and Anderson just need the time down there, even though they're performing well. You just want them to get enough games under their belt in order to make it so that when they do transition, they're not going to be looking like a fish out of water.
And if you listen to Gullitson, he finally said how he plans to use all the defensemen. He said that he's planning to use Grossman against big, tough teams. He's planning to use Kulak against fast teams. And he's planning to use Joki Paka against everybody else. So it sounds like he finally has a plan, which is nice. I mean, that way as a player, you kind of know that you're not just there as the backup. You have a purpose.
Yeah, and like I know a lot of Flames fans were criticizing the decision to go with Grossman against L.A., but it does make some sense. They're a big team that can assert themselves on you, and you need somebody to be able to push back. The problem is that I do not believe that Grossman is an NHL-level player anymore, and I think he got exposed badly during the Kings game, and I don't think that we'll be seeing much more of him, or at least I hope not, because that was pretty bad.
I was honestly surprised after that game that we didn't see him waived and have the Flames leave him in California.
And so was I.
Like, you frank. Know, they're already there. Just, hey, go over to Stockton and you're already here. See you later.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm expecting that. I mean, they're not going to buy him out, obviously, but I expect now that we're home and they, you know, they've got some time to evaluate it, I expect a waiver move to come in the next week. But let's talk about that Kings game. To me, the worst game that we've seen the Flames play, not just this season, but in a long time. The Calgary Flames fell 5-0 to the LA Kings, and sometimes we've said the score doesn't matter. In this one, the score mattered. I mean, we got lit up by the Kings, and we played terribly. And the worst part to me is Devin Setoguchi scores 2 goals against us.
And Peter Budaj gets his first shutout in like 4 years or something like that.
I didn't even
know
Budaj was still around.
Well, Jonathan Quick's out with an injury, and so is their backup, so go with the third guy.
Has he been in the AHL? Like, Budaj was a...
Yeah, he was. He was with the Ontario Reign, even to start the season, so...
He's 34. He probably never thought he'd be in the NHL again.
Yep. And a credit to him that he's actually played well for the Kings. It was LA's first regulation win on the year as well. So, like, not only are they missing their two goalies, they're missing guys like Gabrick and a bunch of other players, and they still steamrolled us 5-0.
Well, that's why last week I predicted that we might be able to beat them, because, yeah, they were missing some of their top players, they're missing Quick. I thought this could be a quick and easy game for the Flames.
Yeah, and as you said, that might have been the worst performance I've seen in the last 15 years. Of any game for the Flames.
It was terrible, and the Flames kept giving the puck away. Like, I'm sitting there watching it, and it's like, come on, guys. How are you giving away? How'd you have 11 giveaways in that game?
Yeah. The entire
team looked
like they were... I don't know
if they were confused because one team was wearing gray and one was wearing white, and they didn't know who their teammate was. But it's like, how are we giving the puck away so much?
Well, the team just looked like they were sleepwalking through the entire contest. Like, I didn't see any enthusiasm from any of the players. It was like they were just getting ready for the Anaheim game from the puck drop, and no desperation at all from any of the players.
No, and that's it. I think, you know, you can't blame the goalie in this one. Usually when you look at a 5-goal game, you pin it on the goalie, but I think all of the 18 skaters in this one just didn't look like they were there.
Well, any goaltender can only do so much, and we've seen enough of Elliott and Johnson to know that they're not giving up any soft goals, really, at any point this season, other than the first game against Edmonton. Elliott let in a couple that were iffy, but since then, each of the goals has been full marks to the opposition, and you just simply can't allow guys to get 2 and 3 and 4 shots in on the goalie and expect them to stop them all. And you need help as a goaltender. You can't do everything yourself. And he was literally getting no help from any of the skaters, and hence 5-0.
So Matt, let's agree to put this game behind us and never talk about it again?
Pretty much.
Well, with that then, let's move on to the next night. The Flames travel from L.A. just up the road to Anaheim, where we have to take on the Ducks in the Honda Center. And as we all know, the Honda Center curse was in full effect, and the Flames now hold an NHL record for most consecutive regular season losses in one building. We've now lost 24 times in a row in the regular season to Anaheim as we fell 4-1. And I think in this one, the scoreboard did not really tell the story. I thought the Flames really jumped back in after LA. I wasn't sure what to expect. I thought the Flames really came in here. I thought they played a good game. But again, they gave up, I mean, two power play goals for Kessler in this one. And they just, they let the Ducks, I think, dictate the game too much.
Well, you look at the goals, right? And on the first one, the Ducks had a handful of shots, and eventually the rebound went over to Clayton Stoner, and he put it in. Then the second one, it was a tic-tac-toe passing play from Getzlaff to Perry to Kessler. None of the defensemen got a stick in the way or tied up the guys. They just let them do what they did. The third one, a two-on-one, where Johnson makes the first save, Gaudreau has a weak effort on the back check and allows Cogliano to get the second shot and score. And the fourth goal was a repeat of the second one. Like, the goalie gave up four goals, but what is he supposed to do with that? You know, there's no help.
And as Brian Burke has always said, he thinks the goalie is responsible for saving the first shot. The second shot has to be the skaters. And in this one, I thought, you know, using that logic, I think that Johnson did a very good job of saving that first shot all night.
Yeah, and none of the four goals were his fault. They were on the defense, all of them.
The Flames, I think, on the other side of the ice, they were playing a lot around the edges of the ice. They were playing along the boards, and I thought they were making a lot of really dumb dumps in this game. Like, they dump the puck in and put it right where the goalie can get it. And that does you no favors, because then Anaheim's just going to take it and go the other way. If you're going to dump it, you got to dump it into the corners where you're forcing them to go in and get it. Like, if the goalie's got it, it's an easy it's an easy rush for the team to go the other direction. So I thought they were making some really dumb dumps. I also thought that the Flames were in it for most of the game, but I thought that they really let the Ducks play. The Ducks didn't give us a lot, to be honest, but I thought that we didn't get enough scoring opportunities because the Ducks were not allowing us to get in front. And there's times when I thought the Flames just weren't fighting as much as they needed to get position in front of the net.
No, and Anaheim's really good with their stick work and just their size. And at times in the game, it looked like the Ducks had six players out there because they were just every time the Flames did anything, they were in the way. And the Flames actually should take a lot of lessons from the Ducks on how to play defense because it was frustrating them all night. And very rarely did they actually get an opportunity to get a scoring chance. And as you said, lots of bad zone entries and just really not doing a good job at executing a game plan, period.
And I think, you know, as much as we looked good in this one, I think this is when you really get exposed. When you play a team like the Ducks, this is where you really get to see the weaknesses in your team and your system.
Can't argue with you.
But, you know, on the plus side to this game, we got to see Matthew Tkachuk's first NHL fight. Interesting fight. I would have liked to have seen a bit of a different result, but I thought it was an okay fight. I also thought that England, again, looked really good, and I thought Kulak had a really nice game in this one as well. What was your thoughts on Hunter Shinkaruk? We saw him make his season debut in this game.
He played?
He did.
That's how bad.
Yeah, I don't know.
I thought he was... I didn't even notice him out there at all.
See, I thought that he didn't look good at the beginning. I was starting to notice him near the end of the game. In the third period, I thought he was doing quite well. I thought he maybe needed the game to warm up a bit. And he was out there with Bennett and Brower for part of the time. And I thought that, I just thought as the game went on, he looked better. I mean, he is coming into a team where, you know, there's probably expectations on you and that sort of thing. It's hard to do, especially coming in against Anaheim. But I guess, you know, good for him is he didn't have all the travel to go through, and maybe that's why he was a bit fresher.
Yeah.
Because he was in Stockton, so I don't know how long it is from Stockton to Anaheim. I don't know my California landscape, but overall I think ending off this trip after the LA game, the Flames made a decent enough showing against Anaheim that, yes, we lost, but I think it gives us something positive to end the trip on as far as the play goes overall and something positive to come home to. Not what I was looking forward to, but if we stunk again like we did in LA, it would have been even worse.
Yeah. It was a better performance, but not good enough. And by the way, Stockton is about a 5-hour drive from Anaheim.
Okay, so probably 360
miles.
Okay, not too bad.
Yeah.
So looking at this trip, one of the big stories was that Matthew Tkachuk played his 10th game, which means we've now burned his contract for the year, and I imagine now he stays the NHL level. Matt, we've talked about this a little bit before. If you were the GM, would you have made the same decision?
For sure. Only for the fact that the Flames don't have any options that are better than him right now. And that's the kind of trouble that the Flames are in. They don't have somebody like a Shin Carrick who can just step in and play a top 6 minute night in, night out, with any realistic expectations that they'll be able to perform well.
See, even if we did, I can't see them sending him down, because from a player development perspective, which is really what you're looking at with your, you know, top picks every year, the top round or two rounds, there's nothing more to be gained at the OHL level, and he's at an age where he can't move on to the AHL or the ECHL, and it just seems to me like there's this weird gap. Like, there's players like Tkachuk where I'm not sure he's quite ready for full-time NHL play yet, but he's too good for the OHL. So you almost, I don't know, you almost want to be able to send him to the ECHL or have a deal with Europe where you could loan him out there for a year. Like, there's maybe this is done for the next CBA, but I think more and more we're seeing players brought up to the NHL just because it's the only option.
Yeah, well, you look at Shillington last year, because he was a European prospect, he was able to play in the AHL. Or sort of like Nylander with Toronto, same situation. And they were able to develop properly there, work on their game, and take the next step. In Nylander's case, Shillington's not quite there yet, but close enough. And instead, like, those players would have had to be in the OHL or Canadian Hockey League, whatever, juniors, if they were North American. And I don't think that that would have been beneficial to their development. So,
it's, I mean, we really don't have any other leagues. So there'd either have to be some sort of exception made that, like, you know, every team's first round draft pick gets an exception of some kind. But see, here's the thing. I don't think Tkachuk, and I mean, we've seen this with other guys in the past, like Mitch Marner and a few other guys. I don't know if they're quite ready for the AHL, because the AHL is still quite a high level of competition. So you almost want like an ECHL clause in there or some sort of European league the NHL is friendly with. It's probably not the KHL, but maybe it's the Swiss league or something like that.
Yeah.
But then the guy's also so far away from the team, so I don't know what the solution is, but it just seems like there almost needs to be this step before the NHL.
Yeah. And one thing that Tkachuk is very good at and will continue to be so is getting under the other team's skin. I can't even count how many penalties he's drawn just because of how much of a pain he is to play against.
And, you know, I've talked about that a few times already on the podcast in the past weeks, but I really like how we're getting the best of both with him. I think he's a top six forward. He can produce offensively, but he's also getting under guys' skins. He's kind of your prototypical Brian Burke player in that way. And I think that going forward, it really gives us a lot of options for how to use him. But the downside is that it might also make him a bit of a target, so he's going to have to watch out there.
And I think we've seen that already with some teams mixing it up with him.
Yep, so, for sure. But I just think that as he goes on and as he gets to be a better offensive player, that target's going to get bigger.
Oh, for sure.
You know, if he can be top point getters, teams are going to want to take him out. Now, luckily, he can hold his own better than somebody like Goudreau, but I think teams are going to try and test him.
Yeah. You know, if he can become Calgary's Brad Marchand, I think that would be perfect and exactly what the team needs moving forward as they transition from being a rebuilding team into a contending team.
Marchand's a good comparison. Couple more notes from the road trip is a couple injuries, which I'm not surprised about. Generally, you go on a road trip like this and you end up with some guys getting banged up. Chris Versteeg left the road trip early. He's out listed week to week with a groin injury, which, you know, I'm sad to see Versteeg leave. I thought that he was just getting warmed up there, and that's why we saw Freddie Hamilton draw into the lineup. And then Lance Boma is now out 2 to 3 weeks with a shoulder injury. And that's why we saw the recall of Hunter Shinkarak. And you and I were looking before the show at Boma. He was injured a lot last year. And I'm starting to wonder if we're ever going to see an 82-game season out of this guy.
I am beginning to think that'll be a no. And I'm wondering if, like, we might have already seen the best of Lance Boma in a Flames jersey.
Well, I said that to you when we signed this contract. I said, I think that we're overpaying him. I don't think he's going to produce like that again. And, you know, it's a bad contract, I think, at this point. Fortunately, it's not too bad. It's only 2.2. But I would not be surprised. I mean, he's under contract till 2017, 2018, next year. I would not be surprised if Boma doesn't come back.
Yeah. And I could even see him being dealt at some point as well.
I don't know. I think it depends how many games we can get out of him. I think if you can't get 50 games, let's say, I don't think many teams are going to want to trade for him. I think I'd almost just take my luck on the free agent market with him.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I think that the fact that he's injured again for 2 to 3 weeks, I mean, these are kind of pivotal time right now for the team. And it's good because it lets us get somebody else in, but I don't think we're ever going to see Boma really play a full season again. I mean, if we look at his time in Calgary, his first year here in 2010, 2011, he played 16 games, 27 the year after. Then when he really made the team, if you will, 78 games in 2013, 2014, and 2014, 2015. So he got 54 points in 2014, 2015. Or no, sorry, 34 points, 54 penalty minutes. That was his best season when we re-signed him. Last year, he played 44 games and got 7 points. And this year, in 13 games, he has 1 point. So I think if you look at those stats, his numbers are slowly going down this year. And I think we'll be lucky to get 50 out of him. Yeah. He just seems too fragile.
Yeah, and with the type of game he likes to play, injuries are going to happen.
And that's where I think he could easily get replaced by a Hathaway or a Lyndon Vay or even a Tkachuk in that kind of a game on the roster. And I think maybe that makes him more expendable now than he was, say, last year. You know, maybe the team doesn't rush to bring him back. Or like you said, if there's a buyer, maybe you look to move him more than you did last year.
Yeah. Well, plus Stockton Heat, they have a second Hathaway-type player in Ryan Lomberg. So you can also, like, if you did end up recalling Hathaway, you wouldn't be really taking that type of player from that lineup because they have two.
Yeah, I think Vay could play that way down there as well.
Yeah.
I think if you need him to transition that, he can. But yeah, I think that Boma kind of had a role on the team that no one else was filling, especially after we saw the departure of, you know, McGrattan and Bolig and all these other tough guys that we had. And now I think that with Tkachuk's play and seeing Hathaway last year, I think that we may be able to replace Boma, and that might not bode well for him. But, I mean, hopefully he comes back from the shoulder injury and he's fine for the rest of the season, but history would dictate he's probably going to be injured for a good part of the season. But I am hoping that Versteeg comes back fairly quickly. I know a lot of people are getting flack, but I like Chris Versteeg as a hockey player for the money we're paying him. I think he's a great addition to the team. And while he might not be your top-line winger, I think that he definitely can slot into this team this year. But Matt, let's talk a little bit about the Flames and where they're at and all these issues. How do you fix this team? And is there a fix?
The solutions are in the locker room. Unfortunately, it simply costs too much to make a trade halfway through a season or 20 games in. Or 15 games in. They don't internally have players that can step in their organizations that they can deal them off. So, like, say the Flames, because they need a top six right winger, or even a left winger for that matter, you can't just go out and get that from some other team because of the fact that whomever you're trading with, they're not likely got having a player in the AHL that is ready to step in, because that player likely would have made their team out of camp.
We also have no money.
True. So it's like the goalie situation last year with Romo and Hiller and Ordeo all struggling at this point. There, you just can't go out and get a starter. That's not how it works right now. And it is frustrating because you can see that there's elements in the team that are good. It's just they're not executing.
I'm not sure at this point making a trade would even help. I think we need to figure out what it is we need to do to activate Johnny Gaudreau and Sean Monahan. Like, when those guys get going, I have no doubt this team's going to pick things up. But it's a matter of, is it just that, you know, maybe Monty's back still hurts and Gaudreau had no training camp, but yet he went to the World Cup, which is kind of similar. I don't know. Something's just, we have to figure out why those guys aren't clicking. Brian Burke said in an interview today that he often sees these guys get, you know, he's seen this throughout his career, he said, where a guy will get a new contract and they'll put more expectation on themselves. I think they need to play a different way because now they're being paid more. And he says it's hard to just tell these guys, we're paying you more, but play the same. Like, just do the same thing because that's what worked.
Yeah. Well, I think part of the problem with Gaudreau and Monahan is that the third player on their line has been a disaster regardless of who it is. And as a defensive coach type of thing, you would just key in saying, okay, these are the two dangerous guys. Who cares about the third guy? If we stop those two guys, the third guy's not going to do anything. So you can kind of key in your team's defense to over attack those two guys because the third guy is just there. And that's not a slight to Chase on, but or Versteeg when he was there, it's just that they're not first line players and the Flames do not have an internal third guy like Hudler was, where he can himself can do some stuff and it makes it easy to defend against. So the team needs those three players need to make adjustments for that, because as we've seen in a lot of games, the defenders are overloading on Gaudreau and double and triple teaming him at times and not giving him any time or space to do anything.
And we saw Gullitson finally break those guys up, and maybe that's the smart thing, is let them kind of play separately and see if they can find their mojo with somebody else. Just because they're the top two players doesn't mean they have to be on a line together.
True, but unfortunately, each of them kind of needs some other talent. And
yeah, but I think like for Gaudreau, you might be able to put Bennett up there.
Yeah, but you know, then like Monahan's going to be on a line with guys like Chiasson and Versteeg, and like, that's not the best usage of him either. So,
but at the same time, if it's not working with Gaudreau, do we have anything to lose by trying them with somebody else? We don't have to keep them there for 82 games.
True, but
if nothing else, it might just kind of reignite them.
Yeah.
I think one of the things for me that we have to do to turn this team around is we have to stop taking penalties. Like, the Flames are one of the, I think, one of, if not the most penalized team in the league right now.
They are.
And that's what's costing us, is we're letting teams like Anaheim, who have a great power play, get on that power play. And we have to stay out of the box. And I don't know what that takes. I mean, these are all professionals. It's not like we have a rookie team. This is a fairly veteran-laden team if you look at it. These guys should have that kind of discipline. And I don't know if it's, you know, guys like Sam Bennett, who somebody needs to sit down with them and work through whatever it is that needs to be worked through, or if they need to, you know, have some more mental conditioning there. I'm not sure what it is, but we have to stay out of the box.
Well, if you look at the Ottawa game, Bennett, Tkachuk, and Versteeg took really dumb penalties, four of them in the first period and a half. And then the coach benched them for the third period entirely.
And
so,
maybe that's what has to happen.
Yeah, and these really dumb penalties like Grossman's that I mentioned from the LA game, you just can't have that kind of crap, period. And when you have it also compounds the problem when you have the 29th ranked penalty kill. Like, if you had the best penalty kill in the NHL, you can kind of get away with taking a handful of extra penalties because more than likely you're going to kill it. But when you're also near dead last in the penalty kill, you're just shooting yourself in the foot.
I think the two go hand in hand, though. The teams that have the best penalty kills often don't take penalties very often.
Well, Calgary, prior to the Dennis Wiedemann incident, for a number of years were the least penalized team, and yet they still had like a mid-20s ranked penalty kill.
So I don't know what we have to do to fix that. I'm not giving up on it yet. I'm not on the Fire Dave Cameron bandwagon, but I think just coming home, watching some more video, and just practicing more. I think you were the one that pointed out that the Flames have had, what, 7 practices all season?
Yeah.
So pretty much 1 practice for every 2 games, and they have 5 practices in the next 7 days?
Yeah, so if they're going to make significant changes over the next week, that's where it'll come from, is having the actual ability to practice things like the penalty kill.
And practice it on your own ice, where you have your own video facilities and all that stuff that goes along with that.
Yeah, and if you look at the penalty kill, one of the things that I believe, and I have always believed, is that you need a really good center iceman in order to win the faceoffs. And thus far, Matt Stajan has done a good job. Because if you win the faceoff, you get control of the puck and you dump it down, that burns 20 seconds by the time they get it back into your zone and set up. So if you can get have the goalie make saves and continue to win faceoffs as there are stoppages, you can burn most of the penalty just from winning the faceoff and dumping it down. But unfortunately, it seems that on the penalty kill, they're not winning a lot of faceoffs, and the defensemen are more or less standing around and not actually doing much to impede any of the forwards at all.
And I think on the other side of that, not only does the Flames need a better PK and a better play in their own end, but they need better offensive entry. I mean, to me, they're not... They have seemed to have no plan a lot of times when they're going up and trying to enter the offensive zone. It's just kind of go up the boards and, you know, push it around the guy in front of you and hope it makes it in. And same thing with puck movement. They need to move the puck more. They need to make the other teams come to them and get out of position. Because it sort of seems like the Flames are now just passing around the other teams when they're set up in their position. And you've got to make them get out of position and open up some space and some shooting lanes, which we're not doing.
Yeah, and... Like, to go back to the power play, one of the main problems that the team has on the power play is that they stand around with the puck, and while they're standing, none of the other players are moving around at all. And so they're just basically passing it in their 5-man box.
We've seen that from the Flames for years.
I know, but that's easy to defend against, and the reason why their power play is 28th.
Well, and that's it. Like, you know, it frustrates me when I see them on the power play. Like, just shoot the puck.
Only shoot the puck, but move. Like, if you're standing still, you're doing something wrong. Everybody on the ice should be moving the time.
But how many times do you see a defenseman just pass back and forth, and it's like, just shoot, put it close to the net. I don't care if it goes on net, put it closer to the net than it is now.
Yeah. Like, if you look at teams like, say, Anaheim and St. Louis, like, if you're actually analyzing what their players are doing, like, all 5 of the guys are moving the entire power play when they're set up in the zone, because they're trying to create those lanes for passes for one-timers. But if all 5 of your guys are just standing still, then anybody can defend against
that quite
easily.
That's it. And when you're on the power play, you have the extra man. So by moving, they can't cover everybody, and somebody's going to be open. And that's the guy you find, you give him the puck, and he rifles it home.
Exactly. And everybody's just been standing around, and it's easy to get the sticks in the lanes to prevent that. And as you said, not getting any shots on net in between the two, the Flames have scored, I think, 4 power play goals on the season. And that's kind of pathetic.
I think in general, the Flames just need better. And again, maybe it's the new system and they haven't worked through it all, but they just need better finish to their game. We see them kind of start something sometimes and then they never finish it. I don't know how many times in the last week I've seen them, you know, come out of their zone. They're breaking out okay. They're going up the neutral zone and then they get over the blue line. It seems like they have no idea what to do anymore. They're looking for somebody to pass it to and then just turning the puck over. Like, there's got to be some finish to whatever you're doing. And the other thing is nobody's in front of the net when they should be. How many times have we seen Flames offense where nobody's there if there was a shot on net to put it home?
Yeah, I know.
So I'm hoping that more practice is going to help with that. But a lot of this stuff is, I mean, you and I played minor hockey, and we know some of this. This is basic hockey positioning and hockey theory. You don't need an NHL coach to tell you this. Like, why are some of these basics being missed by guys that are making millions of dollars to play this game? You know, put the puck on net. That's what my coach always used to say. The closer it gets to the net, the better chance we have to score. So, I don't know. It's frustrating watching the team, but I'm hoping that with a three-day break and some practice time, we'll see some better hockey out of this team. And I think that the Flames are going to be watching a lot of video, maybe not as much on ice, but I think there's a lot of video they can review to figure out what's gone wrong so far.
Yeah. Well, the one thing that I always like to do is look at, like, the teams that are, like, first in the penalty kill, first in the power play, and just analyze how they're doing it. Because it's one of those things that, yeah, certain players are really awesome. Like Alex Ovechkin, you just get him the puck and your power play is going to be awesome. But it's what all of the players on the ice are doing. And seeing, contrasting it with what you're doing. And, like, you look at a defensive system like Chicago employs, you can see that how they are able to defend against other teams and prevent them from doing much of anything with the puck, or Anaheim. And so you might want to steal some of those ideas, like with Anaheim's stick work of getting sticks into lanes and getting close enough where you can interrupt the guy. And when the Flames were successful earlier in the season, they were doing a lot of that. Like the second game against the St. Louis Blues, like, they were just frustrating them because they were on them the entire game, and they weren't allowing them any time or space. And it's just getting that those consistencies of execution, and we're not seeing that. Like, they have had good stretches in games, good games, and then you get a game like LA where it's like, is anybody actually going to show up and play?
Well, and to their credit, I think that we are seeing improvement from last year. Like, to me, we're actually starting to see some sort of a system, especially on the power play. We're starting to see the 1-3-1 formations. You know, we're starting it, to me, it looks like there's the start of something there, but they just need more thought about how to execute on that. You can't just stand in the right position and expect stuff's going to happen. So I'm seeing some positive movement, but they just need finish.
Yeah. That also leads into players struggling. And, like, we've seen Brody and Gaudreau and Monahan, they've all been borderline.
And I think in the end,
terrible.
It's all hand in hand. Once those guys start picking it up, they're going to pick it up. You know, you don't just not struggle on special teams. I think once our top players start picking it up, the whole team's going to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
Special teams, even strength, everything. And I'm hoping that, you know, coming home and sleeping in their beds for a week might help them get going as well. But yeah, I don't know. But Matt, I mean, is this rock bottom? Can the team get any worse right now? To me, I think that we have a whole bunch of messes as we're talking about, and I almost feel like we have to rebound from here. Like,
you look at that article by Darren Haynes from a couple weeks ago where he was mentioning when you get a new coach and how teams struggle for a while. Well, most of them struggle for about 15 to 20 games, and then they get better. Well, we're at game 14, and yeah, the Flames are 5-8-1. That's not anybody's ideal in any stretch of the imagination. But if they can, they have 12 more games this month. If they can go, say, 7-5 or, you know, whatever, something along those lines where they're inching closer to being 500 by the end of the month, then as we look deeper into the schedule for December, January, and February, like, there's a lot of easier opponents in those games. So if the team can pick it up.
And to be fair, right now, we are tied with Dallas for the second wild card in terms of points. So it's not like we're last in the West. You know, we've got 11 points right now, and so does Dallas. We could be Arizona or Vancouver or Nashville, who are still at the single digits. So we're not doing that bad.
No.
And I don't think this team's going to explode. And I think you're right. We just need to give them some time under the new coach, like we were talking about with, you know, Hainsey's article. But, I mean, and we're seeing flashes of brilliance, which isn't something that we really saw last year. You know, we saw, what, one good stretch last year, and that was about it?
Yeah, that 7-game winning streak in December where they weren't even really that good in each of the games.
And so, to me, we're seeing flashes of a good team, and I think it's just a matter of getting everybody on the same page, and this team's going to look good. And I'm glad that we're struggling now as opposed to having these struggles later on.
Yeah, and like if you look at it, the Flames' third and fourth lines have both been awesome for the entire stretch of the season. The second line's been hit and miss, and the first line's been terrible. Well, if you can get the first line going where they're just even good, not even great, just good, then that will have a ripple effect all the way up and down the lineup. It's just hoping that they can actually, with the amount of practices that they have this week, get those things worked out so that way they can execute their game plan a little better.
And I think you have a good point there. If you look a couple of years ago when the Flames made the playoffs, one of the keys to success was everybody in the lineup was contributing. You know, it wasn't just the first line and the second line. I mean, we had, you know, Ferland scoring and Boma scoring and Juris scoring and all these guys who were Bolig scoring, guys who were line three, line four. So if we can keep line three and four producing the way they are, and we can get one and two synced up, even if, like you said, they're not maybe at their top of the game, but I'd say even if line one can get to 80%, we're going to be where we need to be.
Well, like if you imagine the Chicago game, right? If the Gaudreau line and that were on their game, maybe we head into that third period up 2 or 3 to 1 instead of tied. And then if Chicago scores that second goal, then the Flames aren't going to be trying to push for the equalizer, which that's what led to the third goal, is that a guy pinched and allowed the Mott, I think, to come in and beat Brody on a one-on-one and score. Well, you know, if those guys were going, then perhaps that game's a win instead of a loss. And you can go back through the season in the losses, like at the Washington game, where if you're getting something out of the top six, maybe those losses turn into wins. So it's just frustrating. But
and on the plus side there, I think we are seeing a good game from Gaudreau in Anaheim.
Yeah, and Monahan, they both look good.
So hopefully that'll awaken the beast.
Yeah, and they only have a handful more games against good teams, and then they go into that long stretch where they're playing inferior opponents.
Well, I think that might help too. You know, if you look at the schedule coming up, we have Dallas, New York, Minnesota, Arizona, Chicago, Detroit, Buffalo, Columbus, Boston, Philadelphia, and the Islanders in Toronto. Like, it should be a fairly easy month to recapture whatever it is that we need to recapture here. We don't have a lot of teams that are going to be really dangerous in this month.
Yeah, well, like, if you look at our schedule from the 22nd of October on, you've got the Blues twice, the Hawks twice, Washington, San Jose, LA, and Anaheim. Like, that's murderer's row, really. Like, those are, like, all the elite teams. Not necessarily LA this season, but you know what I mean. Like, there's
some very
good teams.
We got through a tough stretch,
though. Yeah. And the Flames won 3 of the games. They ended up losing five of them.
And really, outside of one night, we're at home for the next 2 weeks. Like, mm-hmm. we go to Minnesota for one night, we come back the next night and play Arizona, so I'm hoping that that's going to help the team, because then we're on the road for a week and a half after that. So I'm hoping that maybe just some quality time at home, which we really haven't had so far. You know, we had a three-game stretch last month, but having 2 weeks, really, where you're at, well, yeah, almost a full week and a bit, let's call it 2 weeks, at home, I think might help these guys too. You know, like we're talking about practicing, being at the rink together, working out, watching the video. I just feel like something needs to click, and it always seems to click when you're at home than when you're on the road, when it's familiar. But, you know, all in all, I mean, I'm not unhappy with the Flames' overall standings. I think that we earned ourselves some padding earlier in the year, which is what you have to do. You have to play those good games. Then you can't afford to have three or four bad ones in a row. You know, because, I mean, we had five wins in a row for a while. No, we beat Buffalo. We beat Chicago. We beat the Blues. So, you know, we had a whole bunch of wins there in October. And that really gave us the padding to say, okay, we didn't do as well as we wanted in California, but we got some wins. And I see no reason we can't string it back together again.
No. Yeah. And, like, after the 18th, the Flames can win three of the five games that they play between now and then the team will be looking a lot better, and we can start looking ahead to when the Flames are playing those inferior teams, the Buffaloes, the Columbuses, the Flyers, the Islanders, and the Leafs, and okay, maybe we can start getting on a roll and get back up to 500 before we hit December. Or we might not, and if the Flames are, say, four or five games below 500 by the end of the month, then I think we're starting to take a look at which of the top 10 picks we're going to be looking at drafting, and there's four right wingers, so we'll at least be able to address that.
You know, the Chicago Cubs won the World Series, and I mean, they had the curse of the goat on them. I'm wondering if we almost have the curse of the Hanna Center and some sort of hex that Iggy left on us, where maybe we're not going to get started till Christmas time.
Yeah. Who knows?
Maybe did some voodoo magic on his way out of town, because this is almost like an Aginla team again. It's like, you know, we sort of have some flash of brilliance, but the top guys don't get started till Christmas time, and by then it was often too late.
Yeah. Well, hopefully that's not the case moving forward, but
yeah. Why don't we talk about something that's been good, and that's the Stockton Heat. I'm really impressed with this team this year. It's fun hockey to watch. I got to watch the Gulls game, and well, both of the Gulls games actually. But these guys are dominating in the AHL.
Yeah, they're all right. You know, nothing really to be too concerned over there.
The pink jersey was weird, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, not only that, the ice was pink.
Yeah, I saw that too. But it was, I mean, the ice, I sort of got it was a muted pink. But for those that don't know, they took the Flame striping pattern. So we're in their black jersey. So it's the Flame striping pattern, sort of. It was changed a little bit, and they made it pink. And so the Stockton logo, which usually red, was pink. It was really weird. And yeah, but I mean, they played well. And, you know, it definitely shows on the scoreboard there. They won the first game on Friday 6-1, and they won the second game 7-3. So they're lighting the lamp down there, and I think that's going to make it really easy for the team to start calling guys up when they need to, because you've got great offensive production.
Yeah, like Andrew Mangiapane, he has 9 points in 7 games, which is very good for somebody just making their AHL debut. Emile Poirier, who's had his difficulties, has 6 points in 8 games. Klimchuk and Jankowski are tied for the lead with 10.
I'm really happy to see Klimchuk turn things around down there.
Yeah, he's already actually broken the amount of goals that he had and the amount of points that he's had already through 7 games that he's played. And I think he played like 58 games or something like that last year, and he only had like 3 goals and 9 points. So he's doing well. Shinkarak had 7-7, and Shillington and Anderson both have 6 points in 8 games. And a good thing is that Shillington actually leads the team as a +10.
That's crazy. You know, there's that old saying that old dogs can't learn new tricks. Obviously, the system's not that hard to figure out because Stockton's got it.
Yeah. Well, you can even see that in the AHL, the other teams, you can tell that there's a lack of talent. And I think the Flames would have a lot more success if they were playing easier teams. And that goes without saying at any point. But I think that transitioning to the new system, the Stockton Heat are able to transition because when they make mistakes, they're not going in the back of their net. And where in Calgary, like at the Anaheim game, they only made about 5 or 6 mistakes in the game.
But they're against an elite team that'll make you pay for any mistake.
Yeah, and 4 of them ended up in the net. So it's frustrating, but hopefully the Flames can learn to minimize those mistakes, so hopefully they can transition to wins. Whereas in Stockton, like, they're just steamrolling everybody, basically.
And, I mean, Stockton's team looks built to win this year. It doesn't just look like what we see in the AHL. A lot of times it's just a collection of young guys. It looks like it was built a certain way. And, you know, you see guys like Lyndon Vay, who the Flames got some criticism for signing, but he's been a good veteran presence down there this year. You know, you see guys like Brandon Bolig doing pretty well down there. Even some of the guys like Matt Fratton. You know, these guys are helping out and doing what they can. And I think that they're really giving that veteran balance that you need to a team.
Yeah. And they're currently 2nd in the entire league in goals with 37, or 3rd, pardon me, with 37. But they've played 3 less than the Texas Stars, who have 2 more, and 4 less than the St. John's Ice Caps, who have played 4 more games. So, yeah, they're basically, for goals 4 per game, they're 1st, and they're currently 2nd in the Pacific Division behind Tucson, who actually is the only team thus far to actually beat Stockton, and they've done so 3 times. But overall, they're doing really well.
Another interesting thing, if you take a look at the roster, and he played in the last 2 games, is Keith Ollie is playing for that team. A name that I never thought I'd see back around the Flames organization. But he's playing down in... he was signed his first contract with the Flames in 2009 and never really did a lot here. He was traded to the Maple Leafs as part of the Phaneuf deal. And now he's back with our AHL team. So I guess in the grand scheme of things, we didn't lose a great prospect there. If you're an AHL free agent just a few years later at 27. But I always kind of liked Ollie, and I just never thought I'd see him back here. He's wearing number 43 if anyone watches those games.
Yeah. Well, Colby Roback, his tryout ended, and he signed with another team. So they needed to replace that veteran guy, and so they brought Ollie in his place. And he's not bad. He's what you would expect an AHL veteran defenseman to be.
Yeah, he was, I think that he had a tryout with the Monsters earlier this year.
Yeah, Cleveland.
Yeah.
So
or the Lock Monsters. But yeah, it's kind of interesting that, you know, since it's the devil you know versus the devil you don't, right? I'm sure that the Flames in their archive somewhere have some good scouting on Ollie, considering he was around here for a bit and knew what they were getting into.
Well, not only that, but Burke kind of traded for him, so.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. So, but yeah, good to see them doing well. I'm glad to see guys like Shinkarik picking things up down there when he was down there before he got called off. I'm glad to see Klimchuk doing well. It really makes that decision, I think, of the Flames decide, you know what, maybe we have to sit some of our NHL players for a night or two to give them a night off and try to refocus them, and it gives us an easy time to call guys up.
Yeah, and currently they're 6th overall in point percentage in the league, so off to a good start.
And nothing else, I'd like to see them at least run for the Calder Trophy this year. That'd be fun.
Well, even a playoff series would be nice.
Yeah, so I know people often like to, you know, do the California road swing for the Flames. Flames fans will go on the California road swing. Maybe if Stockton can make the playoffs, people put on their bulletproof vests and head to Stockton for a series. I've heard it's dangerous there. I don't know. I've never been there. Have you ever been?
No.
I'm told it's not a great town, but I've looked online and I haven't seen any evidence of that. So I don't know what people are talking about, but I remember when we first moved the team there, people said they'd wear bulletproof vests instead of shoulder pads.
Yeah.
But overall, they're looking really good. It's interesting to see. Like I said, I got to watch two games this week. So if you can watch Stockton Heat hockey, it's fun hockey to watch this year. Last year was kind of meh, but this year I'm finding it to be quite fun. And I think for those who've never seen an AHL game, the AHL's got a better pace to it than you think it's going to. I think a lot of people think it's like WHL hockey, which there's nothing wrong with WHL hockey, but it's definitely a step up from the Canadian Hockey League. If you're used to watching Hitmen hockey, it's better than that. It's not quite the NHL, but depending on the teams they're playing, there's not much difference some nights.
Well, just think of it as like a matchup between the Edmonton Oilers and Buffalo Sabres from last year.
There you go.
That's what most of the games are like. Kind of slow at times, but there's some skill there, and yeah, it depends on which team, obviously. Like Stockton, I think they could have beat the Oilers last year.
But that'd be a fun preseason matchup. I've still said, and I've said this for years, I would like to sometimes see a inner squad game with the Calgary Flames opening day roster versus the Stockton Heat.
Yeah.
You know, like most of the guys are here anyways, just play them before you cut them. I think it'd be kind of fun to, I think the young guys would have something to prove, you know, can you light the lamp on Elliot? But speaking of goalies, John Gillies got hurt this week. Kind of worrisome to hear that, but luckily you think he's going to be ready for the next game. He had a hand injury in the final game this week.
Yeah, he's just having some difficulty holding on to his goalie stick, and when you're beating the tar out of your opponent, you can just have a seat. We'll get somebody else in there.
So our backup goalie, Tom McCollum, who I still think the Flames brought in just for expansion draft purposes, but he played. And from I didn't see that part of that game. I had to, well, I saw parts of it, but I didn't know how long Gillies was up for. He didn't look too bad.
Yeah.
Acceptable AHL backup, let's put it that way. And that's really what you need. I mean, Gillies is probably going to play 80%, if not 90% of the games this year. So I think McCollum's a suitable backup. Well, Matt, coming back from Stockton, anything else about the Flames you want to talk about?
Not really. Just waiting and seeing how they respond to having some practice time and if they can get on the same page with each other.
And we'll find that out. I think it's nice to kind of come back from this road trip and have two games in a week. I think the team just needs some rest right now. They look like they were running out of gas in LA. I think that coming back from the Honda Center, they could probably just use a nice rest. And they got 3 days, so that's awesome. But let's get into our predictions for the next week then. Looking back at last week, neither of us did very well at all. We had 8 points, 4 games on the table. And we got 2 points overall. You had the exact opposite, Matt. You thought they'd win everything but San Jose.
Yeah. I'm wondering if we should have like a special category to see like when we're perfectly wrong. And like have a tally on that to see like who really screwed up.
Well, you'd beat me every year then.
Yeah, pretty much.
And I thought that we'd win against Chicago and LA. And I mean, Chicago, they at least put out a good effort. LA, it was a terrible game. But yeah, overall, I think that neither of us did great, but the Flames had a weird week as it was. So this week we have 2 games coming up. The Flames have a bit of a break until Thursday the 10th when they play here at home against the Dallas Stars. And then again on Saturday the 12th, they have a game against New York Rangers here at home. If you want to go to any of those games, I've noticed the Dome's been a little emptier lately. So if you want to go to any of those games, there's probably tickets available. Check out our friends at TickTix. You can download their app for Android or iOS and get some tickets through them. But weird week coming up. It's 2 teams that I think could go either way. What's your thought, Matt? How do you think this week's going to shake down?
I'm thinking that they're going to snap out of it and get 4 points. I think the practice time will be enough to turn it around.
The practice time, sleeping on their own beds, all those things?
Yeah. Just enough to get a little more comfortable with things.
Well, since whatever you tend to predict doesn't come true, as we saw last week and we've seen in the past, I'm going to go the exact opposite. I think, unfortunately, the Flames are going to get skunked this week and get 0 points. I think that their woes are going to continue, and they're not going to figure it out till later in the month.
Yeah. So you're just going to, from now on, pick like the exact opposite?
We'll see how it works this week. We'll see how it works. If I get 2 points this week, I might have to keep doing that.
Yeah.
Because you tend to either be very optimistic or very pessimistic. You're either like all in or none in.
Yeah. Well,
and I'm always trying to split the difference and figure out, you know, like I guessed 1 point at one time. And I don't know. I think sometimes I overanalyze it. I think that this is a very, at least right now, this is a very simplistic team.
Yeah. Well, if the Flames were playing 3 games this week, I probably would have went for 4 points and, you know, pick one of them to be a loss. But with only two, you know, it's, yeah, I'd just rather
they should be able to get
hopefully
2 points.
Optimistic, and I'm kind of expecting 2 points. But
so if we get 2 points, who do you think we win against, Dallas,
Dallas
or New York?
Dallas.
I think we're going to have trouble with the Rangers. We usually do.
Well, the Rangers have already scored 5-plus goals in 8 games this year, so. And I do believe they're leading the entire league in scoring. With how the Flames are playing defense, they have 55
the
goals.
Rangers are dangerous this year.
Yeah, 55 goals in 13 games. And
yikes.
You only have Philadelphia and Chicago at 47 and then 41 for the next closest. So I'm not really expecting too many good things from the Rangers game. But
maybe when we play Columbus on the 23rd, call it McCollum and let them light him up.
Yeah.
Like they did with Montreal. But yeah, I think if we're going to win this week, it's going to be Dallas. And I'm glad it's Dallas first, because I think you can ride that positive wave into New York. I think if it was New York first, we might see a different result there. But yeah, New York will be a good test for this team. So we'll see what happens. I think we're going to get 0 points this week, and Matt thinks we're going to get 4, but we shall find out. So Matt, I think that's pretty much it for the Flames this week.
Yeah, next week will be fun. We'll have 5 games after our next show.
It's going to be a busy week, so they better rest and recover this week and be ready to go. Because yeah, then the next week they have 5 games in 7 days.
Fun times.
Yeah, and I mean 2 of those are at home, but we get into what I'm calling our back-to-back session of the month. If you take a look, the 15th and 16th we play back-to-back, the 20th and 21st we play back-to-back, and the 27th, 28th we play back-to-back. So a lot of back-to-backs coming, which means we're going to be seeing a lot of both goaltenders coming up, I imagine.
Yeah.
Which is fine. I don't think that one goaltender's hand over fist better than the other at this point. I think we're getting good goaltending from both guys.
Yep, just not good play from anybody else.
No, but I mean, you know, sometimes you go in, you're like, oh, crap, back-to-back, backups in, we're probably going to lose this one. I think that either goalie can give us a chance to win on any night. It's just a matter of, like you said, what the other 18 guys on the ice decide to do. So let's see what Gullitson can do with these boys. And Matt, we will talk to you again on the 14th.
Hopefully it's a good week for Flames hockey and we'll have a positive show next week.
Even if the team loses, try to find the positives. And that's what I've been trying to do. I'm trying to look at how has their game changed or how is it better than it was. Try to find those positives in the game. And I think you'll have a bit more fun.
Yeah.
All right, my friend. Well, you have a good week and we'll talk to you next week.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Have a good one.
This has been another Fireside Chat. Don't forget to subscribe to the show at firesidechat.ca. Follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/firesidechat. And to follow us on Twitter at Fireside Podcast. Catch our show on the podcast channel at thehockeywriters.com. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-Alike license. Hosted by Dan Stevenson and Matt Dubourg. Produced and edited by Peter Marino and Ryan Coetz.